Okay, well, we will continue with another keynote given by Martin Seeleib-Kaiser, Professor of Social Science at Oxford University, but also, very importantly, member of the Executive Board, like Elena as well, of the BU Citizen Consortium, and coordinator of Work Package 6 on social rights. And he will enlighten us with a presentation on migrant citizens, welfare states, and social rights, which I didn't dare to talk about. Martin, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Sybe. I think I'm going to speak without the microphone, hopefully loud enough. If you can't hear me, let me know.
They are recording it,
okay. So I take the microphone because it's healthier to walk around than to sit. Yeah? Okay. But, you know, perhaps. Is this on? Okay. Good. So, first of all, why do I talk about EU migrant citizens, right? So if you follow the politically correct Sybe talk, he spoke about mobile citizens, right? EU mobile citizens, or mobile EU citizens, as the European Commission likes to see it, right? However, I think we have an issue here that, because we have different categories. We have EU citizens, all of us might be EU citizens, but we live in different countries. And some of us might be mobile citizens, that is, you are posted or a frontier worker, or some of us are migrant citizens, so we have moved to a country with our national citizenship, and, you know, and mostly I'm looking at are people who have actually moved their location, who are not, you know, just EU citizens in Italy, you know, Italian EU citizens, but have moved somewhere. Personally, I'm really interested in that because I am currently, I'm a migrant worker, an EU migrant citizen, and starting October, I will be posted to the country where I have the citizenship of, right?
Okay.
Welfare states are really important. As was already mentioned in one of the presentations, we have different welfare states in Europe. So, you know, Italy, for example, is one of the countries that doesn't even have any social assistance. So one could speak, basically, according to our Swiss colleague, Franz-Sava Kaufmann, who would argue, well, there is no social citizenship in Italy because there is no minimum income scheme, which is one of the only countries, well, you know, in association with Greece and some other, but basically Italy is the one. Now, there are legal rights, legal social rights of EU citizens, but then there are also substantive social rights. And I think that is really important if we think about social citizenship, because it's not about whether you have legal access to something. So, for example, in our project, we have, you know, people, colleagues from Central and Eastern Europe, and they say, well, you know, everyone has the same access to social rights, but there are basically no social rights. So what does that mean in terms of citizenship if you have access to something which substantively is irrelevant? Okay, and then I'm going to talk about the European Index of Free Movement and Social Rights. By the way, and I should highlight that, this is a paper because Sybe is so stingy, together with two of my PhD students who are funded through an ESRC project. I think what the project did actually is interest me in the whole matter, of and expand on that. Now, as I said, social rights can be legal and substantive, and we have different. You know, very often it's argued that the type of welfare state matters for the integration of immigrants, and but we have then different legal statuses. We have asylum seekers. We have European citizens, and so forth. And European citizens are very often in this migration literature treated as one category, as having the same rights as nationals. Some others who are more familiar with EU citizenship, like Maas and Weiler, argue that still the worker status is core. Yes, might be the case, but what that does not necessarily acknowledge that much is that actually the European Union has made some progress, and I just want to highlight that before I go to the details and become more critical, is yes, there has been huge progress. Nevertheless, EU citizens' legal and social rights are stratified by economic activity, whilst the substantive social rights are defined by the respective member states of origin or destination. Right? So it's economic activity, but then member states of origin and destination matters. And, you know, limited substantive rights can severely restrict EU citizens' freedom of movement and undermine the whole concept of EU citizenship, as I will show. Okay, core to EU citizens' social rights is their right to free movement. Yeah, so I'm only talking about those who are actually moving across borders, not about those without social rights in a member state country. EU citizens' right to reside and their access to social rights in a member state which they do not hold citizenship continues to be heavily stratified by during the first 5 years, as we heard in the presentation basically, right now, is the issue of within the first 5 years, you have to have your own means to support yourself. Stark distinction between EU workers and other EU citizens. Okay, workers have the same rights, basically, although there might be some minor kind of issues from a legal perspective. One can have long discussions about that. And I'm here talking about those who have relocated. I'm not talking about frontier workers or posted workers, which are different, two different kind of categories. Now, we have economically inactive EU citizens. They usually need comprehensive sickness insurance and sufficient resources. Overall, we have the importance of social security coordination. I think that is really important. And we usually think about people coming from country A to country B, that they should be entitled in country B to social rights. But that is not what the EU initially was about and what social security coordination is about. Now, if we put it on a table, we see that they are really differentiated. Pensioners, for example, export their pension entitlements from the country where they retire, and also the basically costs for sickness insurance is paid for by the country competent for the pension. All of them, however, in terms of family benefits, could have access to family benefits. Students, and I think that is also a great success if one thinks about 1980s and even before, is with the European health insurance card. So they're insured against sickness in their country of origin and take that European health insurance card, and that then covers them. So, but what this actually shows is that it's highly stratified. And the big issue is you very often the job seeker. Stereotypically, especially in the country that I live in currently, is kind of these East Europeans who come and, you know, want to have British benefits. Yeah, as we see here. When they come, they should initially export their benefits from the countries where they come from. Okay, and most countries now enforce the three-month rule that you cannot have access to any kind of social assistance benefits. Initially, Britain did not do that. So all the discussions leading up to the 1st of January 2014, in Britain you could arrive and immediately have access to job seekers' allowance, despite the xenophobic discussion. So only on the 1st of January 2014 did they change that, which is quite interesting. Now, we look at three dimensions: unemployment, pensions, and child benefits. Now, and this on the first hand looks really, really confusing, probably, okay? What we did here is we took an unemployed person who earns 67% of the average income, because 60% of people that move are young people. Young people usually earn less than the average, okay? And they can come from these countries. Here we have 27 members, 20, no, 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 26. So we excluded Luxembourg, and Croatia might not be in there as well. Luxembourg is Luxembourg, we excluded Luxembourg because in order to identify the average income, Luxembourg is an interesting case with 500,000 inhabitants, 40% of whom are EU officials, so there are issues with that. Okay, so, but this is probably the most comprehensive. So let's say you come from Denmark, you migrate to Denmark, so it doesn't matter. Okay, But what this shows is the net difference between the unemployment benefit that you are entitled in your country where you originate compared to the country of destination. So, for example, if you're unemployed and receive 67% of average income on a weekly basis in Denmark, you're entitled to €367.70. If you're unemployed in Romania, you're entitled to €27.21 a week. Now, this construction then means that if you're a Danish person and go to Romania, you are €340 better off than the unemployed Romanian during the first 3 months that you export your unemployment benefit. However, if you come from Romania and go to Denmark, you are €340 worse off than the Danish person, right? And this is about EU citizenship. We designed the social security coordination for migrant workers not to be worse off when they move. We colored in green the countries where basically you can move within 75%. So up to 75% of the country of origin. Amber are the countries between, or the instances between 75 and 50%, and red is when you're below 50%, right, of the country's benefit, the country of destination's benefit in terms of unemployment, right? So what social security coordination does, although intended, and you can see which countries are all green, right? You know, it's old Europe with the exception of unemployment of Great Britain because it has a liberal welfare state and has only a very low benefit. So in Britain, the weekly benefit, exportable benefit is about 90 euros. Okay. Why we use that is because we follow kind of conventions in terms of social policy welfare state research. Is there social democratic countries, which are the Nordic countries, the conservative countries, which are the continental Europeans, and then they're liberal, then they are, as Maurizio Ferreira and others would have highlighted, Mediterranean countries. With the Eastern Europeans, they belong to various different mixes, and people would argue they are hybrids, right? And in terms of Mediterranean countries, it's also important, with the exception of Italy, that we have see certain issues here, right? Because they have really weak systems in terms of unemployment system. I'm not saying that Italy's is the strongest one, but it differs, you know, from the one that you know, we have, for example, in Greece. If we take the you know, this ideal typical kind of character that we created with 67%. So in Greece, you would have a weekly benefit of 81 euros, whereas in Italy you have one of 218. Yeah? Assuming these people are entitled to, and right. But what this shows is that I think social security coordination creates what we call poverty migration, because all these people, when they come to the countries of destination, and some countries like Romania, but these three, or basically Romania in any country, he or she will be worse off, right? You can do the same with pensions. And here you see different patterns to some extent, but overall, it's again the East Europeans that are discriminated against. Pensioners, you know, if we think about freedom of movement beyond the worker, so it's the unemployed that should be able to move, or pensioners, right? Think about all these British people who are living in Spain or in the south of France. We enjoy ourselves, you know, with our, you know, and that is quite interesting in, you know, in terms of the British pension goes much further than some people hope, at least if we believe this data. The issue is with this data, because we needed to take pension expenditure per beneficiary, which is not necessarily the the actual entitlement, but just an average figure. And it might be the case that some people, especially in some countries where you have huge gender differentiation, labor market participation, that you have very tiny pensions partly, which then overall reduce the overall amount per beneficiary, as you will see in Germany, because no one would expect that Germans' pension is actually so low, at least for the current pensioners, not for the future pensioners. Nevertheless, again, here you see certain countries that can move to other countries and retire, make use of the right to freedom of movement within the European Union based on the pension rights that they have acquired. Others can't without becoming, you know, poverty migrants. And I think that is really something to think about. And this is not only about rich and poor people, it's about countries, because we always take the average, right? So it's not, you know, we still have poor people in Italy, we have poor people in Germany or Britain. This is about average people. Now, then we have the interesting issue of child benefits, which is the issue we in Britain really don't like, right? Because these East Europeans, they come and work in Britain, and then their kids stay in Poland or Hungary, and they get these really large benefits, as if we would believe the debates, right, of 20 pounds a week or so. Well, first of all, you know, despite trying to remind the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, who have asked me at some point to give them some advice what they should do in terms of these damn Europeans and the stealing of benefits, but I was not necessarily that effective, and I'm sorry for that, Sybe. I mean, that I didn't have greater impact on that. Nevertheless,
okay, we'll talk about it later.
Nevertheless, the British child benefits are not the highest. It's Denmark with the highest ones, and then it's basically Germany that has really high, you know, only 11 euros lower than the Danish one. And this takes it only into account, again, kind of an ideal one, monthly child benefit, and under certain kind of considerations, I think I have to look at it. For the first child, if the child is younger than 1 year, because it's very difficult to get to any average, because many countries have, you know, if the child is older than 3 years, goes to school, doesn't go to school, that you have all these complicated things where you cannot actually get a picture on what is happening. So, if you, and this is between country of origin, this is if the child migrates. Right? So, because the child also has a freedom of movement, obviously, is a citizen. Okay? So, if the child migrates, a Bulgarian child migrates to Denmark, you know, that child will be 181 euros less well off than a Danish child, or a child living in Denmark, not migrating. Now, but this is the flip side of what is usually talked about or imagined. Just change the color, reverse them, and see the red as green and the green as red. It is then the workers moving, right? So if the Bulgarian worker moves to Denmark and his children stay in Bulgaria, his children will be 181 euros better off than if he had stayed in Bulgaria, because he is entitled to the Danish child benefit, which will be exported, right? So in terms of child benefits, the only kind of social benefit in terms of social security coordination where East Europeans adults can benefit in terms of actually be better off than West Europeans when they migrate, because very often these benefits are higher in the countries of destination, and they export them from those countries, whereas they would export the unemployment benefit to the country of destination. So, I think what we need, or what we then did, is we developed a European Index of Free Movement and Social Rights. It indicates the degree of freedom of movement based on the entitlement to substantive social rights. So, what we did, for every country in every category, so job seeker, pensioner, or child, we calculate the effective freedom of movement, that is the number of countries the respective EU citizen can relocate to without being significantly worse off than their counterparts in the country of destination. Significantly worse off is more than, you know, less than 75% of the benefit, right? Average effective freedom of movement across entry categories for each country, we do that. And third, we divide the data into three parts. We look at basically, and I'm going to show that in a map in a second, we have full freedom of movement. These are the countries in orange. These are the, you know, citizens in these countries. They are the true, they can enjoy EU citizenship. They can relocate in the green countries. They can relocate to any country and are always better off, or within the 75%. Yeah? Which is Austria. Then we have these, you know, as we would hope and think, right? Two countries. We have Ireland. We have Denmark, Finland, and Sweden. Then we have Greece and Eastern Europe, and the rest is amber. And let me see whether I can also have the numbers here with, we had a table. For example, someone from Denmark, in our sample of 20, we had 25 countries, so it's Luxembourg, Croatia. Okay. So a person from Denmark can travel to 24 countries without being worse off. So absolute freedom of movement across, you know, being a job seeker, a pensioner, or a child. In all three categories, he or she would be, you know, a true European, having freedom of movement, not being worse off. Now, the Romanian, if he were a pensioner, can travel to two countries without being worse off. And if he or she is a child, can travel to three countries without being worse off. So the average for Romania, for example, is, taking all three dimensions into account, is 1.67 countries, right? Or 7% of the European Union, whereas a Dane can travel to 100% of the European Union. And I think this is more relevant than these other kind of issues, whether I'm a poor person, unemployed person. This actually shows the structural deficit of the European Union. And what this also then means is, because I think without a social dimension, we will be losing Europe. So we need to address that. Because these people here are identified here in these amber or green countries as poverty migrants. They want our benefits. However, they should be exporting their benefits, but due to low living standards, if they export their benefits, they are automatically poverty migrants. Or if they don't work, right? I'm not saying and or, you know, they are all obviously rich, but an average person has no possibility to use his or her freedom of movement. Now, which leads me to the conclusion, classifying EU citizens as a homogeneous migrant category with more or less the same social rights as nationals can be, I think, totally misleading. Certain groups of economically inactive EU migrant citizens, such as job seekers and pensioners, export their benefits. And we always have to remind ourselves that that was the initial idea, and that's why we have the 3 months, right? And this can lead to significant differences. Also the issue, if you think about the Romanian unemployed worker coming to Amsterdam, London, or Berlin with 27 euros weekly benefit. How long will that last? I can tell you in London, it will not last an afternoon, right? So, which then also opens up the whole issue of exploitation, because this person, if he or she has not prearranged any employment, will have to find a job that afternoon. I.e., that person will take any offering, whether it's legal, illegal, whatsoever, basically to sustain him or herself. I think that is one of the issues that we really need to address. Which does not mean that I want to limit their rights. And as I say, have said or indicated, limited substantive social rights can severely restrict EU citizens' freedom of movement and undermine the whole concept of EU citizenship if we don't limit it just to workers. I'm not saying we have not made any progress, but there are certain issues that I think need urgent attention. I think that what this requires is basically a European-level minimum income scheme. And that would address a number of issues. It would address the issue of social rights of the individual moving, and it might also address the other issue that we have to deal with in the European Union, which is transfers if we have asymmetric shocks in the European Union. So if you think about what happened the last couple of years between, Germany in the center of the focus, but, you know, in the shadow, the Netherlands and Finland, right? And in terms of vis-a-vis Greece, right? So the Greeks were saying, okay, we have to, you know, cut back our social benefits because these other, you know, creditors wanted, you know, to have assurance that they cut, for example, basic pensions also. Well, I mean, there were issues with Greek pensions. I'm not disputing that. But what I'm saying is, if one had a European minimum income scheme, which is not a fixed amount of 400 or 500 euros, but which could be related, for example, to social assistance benefits. For example, in Britain, Germany, or Sweden, the social assistance benefit is about 40% of the median income, right? So basically, if everyone would get 380 euros, something like that domain, funded through the European Union, we would minimize certain issues. One is the poverty migrant would be less of a poverty migrant, would have at least a couple of days to find something, would not immediately be on the street. Secondly, it would also help us in countries which face asymmetric shock, because if it's funded through the European Union, it would not be the Greek budget, but the EU budget, basically through value-added tax. To conclude, as Marshall observed in his classical account, social rights are crucial for the ability of all citizens, irrespective of class, to more fully participate in the community and to enjoy the political and civil rights. That's what he said in 1950. And, you know, although, you know, certain kind of commissioners don't want to look into the past, I think Dahrendorf was right as when he stated in 1985, they are a precondition to full citizenship or the final stone in the arch which holds up the roof of citizenship. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Martin, for this not only very interesting, but definitely also thought-provoking presentation, which raises, I think, a number of interesting issues, but also questions, and, for example, how it relates to findings also in our own consortium from other in other work packages dealing with either the historical perspective or comparative perspective. So I think there we can already see a development of maybe different narratives on citizenship. But very interesting. Thank you so much. And I think what for me is also an eye-opener, not only the fact that we as lawyers look very much at these legal social rights, but of course there's a substantive component as well, factual, more factual maybe what we would say lawyers, a factual component also, but that you should not only look at the country of destination, but also the country of origin. And I think that is very little done also in legal literature. It's very much about the host member state, where indeed you are supposed to easily become a burden, whereas the country where you come from is very little looked upon. So I think this is has an enormous added value to the discussion. So thanks so much, Martin. Now I would like to ask Silvia, Adamo from Copenhagen University, and Maribel Gonzalez, Pascual from Pompeu Fabra, and Elisabetta Pulice from here to join the table. Shall we, later on have a discussion on the presentations like we did the first time, I guess. Yeah?
Is it yours?
No, this is not mine. I don't know which it is. Is it yours, Elena? Okay, I will make some place for you. Sitting here comfortably in the middle. Now, we will have three other presentations. Starting with Silvia Adamo from Copenhagen, all the way from Copenhagen, but also now having relocated home, I think.
Yes, yes.
So, or partly home, because this is your home country at
yes,
least.
Yes.
Although you originate from Tuscany, isn't that true?
Yes.
I remember that, yes.
Yes, very good.
So that's
good.
Another part of Italy.
Yes. Yes.
Well, let's start with you. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Sybe. Thank you, Elena, for this opportunity to come back home. I actually never been to Trento, so it's a pleasure to be here. It's a beautiful city. Yes, I am an Italian relocating to Denmark, and now we just heard how good it is to be born in Denmark. So I hope the next generation of people coming from there will know how much they are favored compared to other union citizens. But I am one of those from those countries that moved from the red countries moving up to the green, as you presented very interestingly. I decided when I was asked to talk about factual barriers and legal barriers and try to tie it up with some of the research that we have done in this fascinating journey that has been BU Citizen, I decided to focus on linguistic barriers for accessing the Danish labor market and society. And I will address this topic in three steps. I decided to talk about the linguistic barriers, how they are, as I see them in practice in Denmark. I also talk about the integration potential that language carries in Denmark. And then I will talk about the legal implications of linguistic barriers. All right, so starting with the first one, how linguistic barriers are in practice in Denmark. And I will talk about Denmark as a mainland. Denmark has, of course, two minority languages, which are Greenlandic and Faroe, but this will not be at the focus of my presentations. I identified three types of barriers that, as I can see them in Denmark. One is a learning barrier. Danish is a very difficult language, I can testify. There are 21 vowels or sound, which are very, very difficult to pronounce. Everybody actually speaks English. Also to people who are trying to learn Danish because they are not used to Danish spoken with an accent. So it's very difficult actually to practice the language. It requires active participation in language courses and this can be difficult to reconcile with an active employment because it actually takes many, many hours. So it's not a language that you can just pick by being in the country and just listening to your coworkers. So this is an experience which is based on anecdotal evidence, I would say, but also from colleagues as a year at the university, which has opened to an international staff. So every, for example, the Faculty of Law, all the communication goes in English and people are employed, even they don't speak Danish, but they are expected to learn within a reasonable amount of time. The state actually sustains knowledge of and learning of Danish language via classes, which are virtually free. There is a small fee, but actually for 3 years, it's possible to attend classes at almost no cost. Another example of this learning barrier is that Danish children at 3 years old are tested in kindergarten about their learning, about how their learning of the language and the spoken language is underway. And the parents actually have the duty to let their children be tested, and in case they are found to be not developing well, they have to take the local council help in developing this. And it, I think it's one of the first examples of shifts from a factual barrier to a legal barrier because it can concretize in the law. The second barrier that I saw, that I could identify as a linguistic barrier, is the employer barrier. So Danish is required for daily interactions, of course, but also to enroll and be employed in a long number of education classes and stuff, but also to participate actively in the labor market. So another example of a legal barrier, many jobs require, of course, a high knowledge of Danish language. And this is understandable when these jobs are used, have a long, when language proficiency is required because there is a large impact on the general public. So for teachers and legal professionals, police officers, it's required by law that they have a high proficiency. But also, this Danish language requirement is employed for jobs that don't have a very high public interaction. And I heard from a friend that he was refused to take a job as a postman. I hear about warehouse professionals. So where there is not really interaction, and still they are not employed. And I will go back to that. There are many problems related to this kind of linguistic barrier in the labor market. The Danish labor market is in shortage of workers. There is going to be, in the coming years, a very huge lack of number that will be missing both highly skilled and low skilled. But workers with limited language skills cannot enter the labor market. So these two counter arguments go together. There are limited areas where non-speakers can work. One is the highly skilled can work, of course, in corporations that work in English or in institutions where English has been adopted as the work language. But in low-skilled areas, there is a limited amount of jobs. So in building, agriculture, transport, cleaning, hotel and service industry, these are the pockets of employment of labor market where this non-Danish speaker can enter. At the same time, there are still some barriers. For example, a couple of weeks ago, the president of Arriva, which is the main transportation, largest companies driving collective traffic in Denmark, criticized the rule that requires bus drivers to take a driving license in Danish because he is in lack of drivers, around 1,000 a year. And at the same time, there is a lot of people that don't speak Danish that would like to work as drivers or maybe can be employed, and he cannot employ them because they don't speak Danish and they cannot get the bus driving license. So he has been criticizing publicly the law. And the problem also that I see that this very difficult insertion in the labor market is there are thousands of asylum seekers that are arriving in Denmark. They don't speak Danish. And because the labor market is so difficult to enter for non-Danes, for non-Danish speaking workers, they are secluded. And in contrast with the now policy of the government to have refugees to work for day one that they are in Denmark. So there is a shift between factual and legal barrier all the times. I've been reading also that telemarketers are required if they have a strange sounding name to change their name to more Dane sounding names. Dorte or Jonas, because if you present yourself as Mohammed to clients, they may not buy from you as if you were called Christian. There is also this an unspoken barrier that I read from an interview with a headhunter, and she was saying that employers simply want to employ foreigners. And this can be because they find it difficult to have non-Danish speaking colleagues amongst them. For example, if a large majority of their client is Danish, or if all their materials, intranet, documents of the firm are in Danish, or simply because they lack the skills or the will to talk in anything else in Danish. So there is this very unrealistic barrier. They want to be on one side. They would like to be international and growing. At the same time, they're very regional and parochial. Finally, the cultural barrier. I think that the Danish national language is closely tied with the understanding of national culture and values. So knowing literature and songs and history form the fabric of the society and of the interaction between foreigners and or among Danes. So no Danish, no Denmark understanding. And this is very clear also from the legal tools that has been adopted in the last decade. This point, this brings me to the second point of my presentation, the integration potential of language. Language has been tied up to the knowledge of language goes hand in hand with going into the labor market and working and learning Denmark and Danes cultural norms. And therefore, it has made the knowledge of Danish language has been made coercive, especially for third country nationals. It has shifted to a legal barrier, but also to an imposition. Third country nationals, and now I shift to the work package 7 from the work package 5. In order to get some civil rights, third country nationals will have to show that they have passed a test of knowledge of Danish language. For example, for family reunification, if a third country national resident in Denmark wants to be reunited with her spouse, after 6 months that they have received their residence permit, they have to pass an A1 test, Common Framework of Reference, European Common Framework of Reference test. If they want to have permanent residence, they want to obtain a permanent residence after 6 years of residence, they can apply. They will have to prove that they have passed Danish test 2 or Danish test 3, which are quite high, level B or C. Finally, for naturalization, it's of course a no-brainer. You will have to be speaking Danish and pass not only the Danish exam, but also the citizenship exam. So language and integration are very much tied. Finally, for my third point, I wanted to present some legal implications, some conclusions of how I see linguistic barriers in Denmark. And I will end on a personal story. When I arrived in Denmark many, many years ago, I could already speak English fairly well and Spanish and French and, of course, Italian. So I presented myself to the job center and I said, I'm here, I'm young, what can I do? And they said, without Danish, you cannot do anything. So learn Danish first. And this is the precondition for everybody. And that may work for, it worked for me, I had the time. I was 20, I took a year and worked in a kindergarten where the kids didn't mind me not speaking too much because they were not speaking themselves, and I learned Danish. But not everybody has the same possibility to take time off in their life to learn a very small language, very limited, sorry, small territory language, not small. Yes.
Forgiven to you.
Yes. So I think the legal implication, the factual implication, is that third country nationals many times are excluded from the labor market, but they're also excluded from society because they don't integrate, they cannot integrate because they don't have civil rights or they cannot make them real. There is an inclusion of union citizens. Union citizens are more protected. So you are not required as a health professional to show via passing of a test that you know the Danish language, but still, in practice, you will be required to learn. You will be tested by your colleagues, more or less, whether you know or you don't know. And then there is always this movement between factual and legal, which is very difficult to grasp and to analyze. The question of what comes first, is it a factual barrier, is it a legal barrier, what is it? And although I think from a diversity perspective, from a multicultural perspective, of course it is a fair expectation for immigrants to be required to learn the language of the country where they decide to reside. It is, of course, needed for social interaction, for public, for democratic participation, for employment, so it is a fair expectation. But when it's made coercive, and when it's actually a roadblock to entering a society, or to have rights, civil rights, then we have to go a little bit more deeper, maybe with the Finnish legal theorist Carlo Tuori, to the deeper dimensions of law and see what lies behind these requirements. And it's a very cultural nationalistic version of language that has to be protected as a part of heritage, and it's required for everybody that comes to live in such a beautiful country as Denmark. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Silvia, for this also thought-provoking presentation. And I think I haven't done really research in the Netherlands, but I guess that I could have a bit similar story, especially when it comes to, for example, family reunification and the requirements to not only speak the Dutch language, but also to know about Dutch society. And I can tell you I won't do that, but that the first questions they had were for those actually seeking a residence permit in the Netherlands, having to do the exam outside the Netherlands, for that matter, but the first questions that I saw were extremely shocking, as if these were children of 5 years old and do not know how to live together in a society. It was really, really terrible. I hope the tests have improved meanwhile. But it's like almost like what would you do if the neighbor is beating his wife, for example, this kind of questions. Well, this is of course a very, this is a kind of, how do you call that, degrading standard sort of for citizens. But what you see, I think what is interesting from your presentation as well, is this kind of tension between, on the one hand, this cosmopolitism, actually, and on the other hand, the focus on national culture and local culture and language plays an important role there. And there you see always this tension, and that seems to have increased in some way, and I think in quite a number of member states of the EU. So on the one hand, the more we seek to integrate with each other, the more focus there will be on national, local, cultural particularities. But I have not really tested this, but I think that's an interesting point also in your presentation. Let's quickly turn to Maribel from Barcelona, who will talk about
Regional identity.
Regional identity.
And barriers to EU citizenship.
That is not surprising, coming from Barcelona, I think, Maribel.
Yes.
Okay. University, Pompeu, Fabra. But okay. The floor is yours.
Okay. My presentation is mostly based on the research that I have conducted for the project. The BU Citizen project allowed me examining the EU with EU citizen lenses, realities that are normally seen as domestic issues, and I have to say I'm a constitutional lawyer. So I have to change a bit the perspective, so thank you for counting with me in the project. I am going to focus particularly on a very simple, tiny, but very controversial case, which is the Catalan rules on trading establishments. This case is a good example of a wider scenario because its raison d'etre is, at the very end, the coexistence of different groups with different interests in Spain. The building of a single market has been particularly complicated in Spain because there's an heterogeneous economic structure throughout the territory, which is linked with a strong regional identity in certain territories. Thus, we do have very strong regional identities with different economic goals in different parts of the country. Unsurprisingly, the constitutional settlement eventually foresaw different regional economic regulations. However, these domestic settlements were put into question where the different national groups become part of a bigger project, the European Union, whose goals are also protected. The clash between the domestic legal system and the European one is sometimes only a matter of time, because that constitutional settlement might even turn into a barrier to the exercise of the EU rights. However, such a clash is not easily tackled, because from the EU perspective, it can be an undeniable violation of EU law, but from the domestic point of view, it can be read as a threat to the regional identity, particularly if the territorial groups have a strong political will and serve features that which strengthen that identity, such as the language. The four cases that could look like easy cases from the European perspective are actually really hard cases from a domestic perspective. In Spain, as you are probably aware, there are very strong and competing regional identities. Those identities are rooted in a different language, but also in a different economic structure. That diversity is much more common within states as we tend to think. It was Talton that said all states at the very end are a bit asymmetrical. However, in the Spanish case, this diversity of ways of life are, to a large extent, even antagonists. Furthermore, the coexistence of territorial groups throughout Spain is legally protected at the constitutional level. Actually, right to self-government is a powerful device to enhance democracy in multinational societies when the groups in question are settled in distinctive territories. In this regard, the allocation of powers between the state and the regions has not been established by chance. Regions wanted to rule on the matters deriving from the regional identity or shaping that identity, economic matters included. In this regard, Catalonia is a region traditionally proud of being a middle-class society based on a small family local stores. It is remarkable that according to the Catalan state of autonomy, that would be like the basic law of Catalonia, the regional government shall protect in particularly a small and medium-sized enterprises. Unsurprisingly, regional rules on trading establishment lay down several restrictions on the locations and sites of large retail establishments in Catalonia. In fact, those rules prohibited the opening of large retail establishments outside consolidated urban areas of a limited number of cities. Moreover, they required the application of sales as regards market share and the impact on existing retail trade. European Commission held that those rules were a violation, freedom of establishment, lots of complaints before the Court of Justice. The Spanish state alleged that the provisions contended pursuit objectives related to town and country planning and environmental protection. The Court of Justice didn't buy it. It stated firstly that the restrictions laid down in the contested legislation affected the possibility of opening large establishments in Catalonia, and secondly that Spain had not sufficiently explained why those restrictions were necessary. That was in March 2011. Later on, the Spanish Constitutional Court dealt with the compatibility of the Economic Activity Promotion Act, passed by the Catalan Parliament in December 2011. This statute again contains several restrictions on the location of large trading establishments. Constitutional Court held that the regions have not proved sufficiently that the rules were looking for town and country planning, that was against the same, and declare the regional provisions unconstitutional, November 2013. Still, this is not the end of the story, because Catalonia approved further measures in 2014, which again constrained the location of large establishments. This decree law has been challenged before the Constitutional Court. The case is pending, but the law has been suspended by the court. The decision of the Constitutional Court bears highlighting because they stretch which the actual aim of the regional rule is. The foreword of all these regional rules emphasize the importance of the local trade for the identity of Catalonia. However, they also pointing out the need to protect the regional economic interests. And this is key for the decision of the Constitutional Court. This is the key because such an aim, the economic policy, has to be in accordance with EU rules on the matter, and it cannot be a barrier for the fundamental freedoms. Then the claim of a regional interest deserving special protection was disregarded. Still, in the case Digibet and Ger Albers versus Westdeutsche Lotterie, the Court of Justice stated that the division of competences between the lender cannot be called into question since it benefits from the protection afforded by Article 4 of the Treaty of the European Union. However, the fact that the German division of competences benefits from the protection of Article 4 did not suffice in itself to satisfy the requirements of proportionality of, for restriction of the freedom to provide services. In fact, turning to our case, why should the regional markets be more protected than the state markets? The EU economic freedoms have put into question the domestic competences on trade throughout Europe. The measures adopted by Catalonia are not that different as the one that has adopted many states to protect their economic interests under the cloth of other goals. Still, why does such a tiny conflict endure in Catalonia? In this case, we have a very important local actor, the Catalan Chamber of Commerce, which can really push for rules within its own community. Moreover, the political power of this community, the regional ones, do not answer directly to the European Union, but to the state, which is an easier arena for them, particularly if there is an ongoing political struggle between them. This makes the local barrier sentence more controversial and long-lasting. That conflict is, let me say, trickier when it is intertwined with a language conflict. In this regard, the Catalan Consumer Code enshrines the right to be attended either in Spanish or in Catalan in any establishment located in the region. Moreover, any consumer information, trade names, purchase offers, advertising, sales agreement, etc., have to be provided at the very least in Catalan. The non-fulfillment of these duties could amount to a fine between at the least 10,000 euros and 100,000 euros to be paid by the owner of the store or the enterprise. Only last year, almost 70 enterprises were fined. A third part of them were not even located in Catalonia. As the Court of Justice has emphasized in the Anton Land case, the Union must respect its rich and linguistic diversity. Still, the Court also found that this legitimate interest view failed to satisfy the requirements of the proportionality principle in this case. But, as Elke Klos has pointed out, the Court explicitly accepted the imposition by member states of the use of a local language on private communications. Therefore, in this second case, the Consumer Code, the answer is not as straightforward as in the first one, even though in both cases we do have a regional rule which is incompatible with EU law and might have the same goal. Let's not be naive. The Consumer Code might be trying to protect economic interests in Catalonia also. The answer cannot be identical. One is rooted in a factual situation, local trade, which in deep contradiction with EU goals, a single market. But the other is rooted in a factual situation also, a regional language that the EU protects. At least the reasoning should be different because the regional identity carries more weight in the second case, and the EU decision might raise deep unrest in the society. Thus, it is not only important both the factual origin of the barrier and the domestic legal provision strengthening the barrier, but also the narrative, the principles surrounding the barrier. However, it is important for me to note that a possible regional identity represents only one of the many identities that people have today, and that identity attached to a region is a contested discourse rather than a permanent truth of the region. That is why I insist that the reasoning must be carefully elaborated, but the response can be in contradiction with the regional desires, because the EU project is at the very end also their project, and their citizens are also EU citizens. And I point this out because sometimes it is forgotten that EU rights are particularly important to overcome domestic barriers for the ones living there, especially the ones who are really politically controversial, as the ones that I'm presenting today. So, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Maribel, about a regional, very interesting also presentation about regional diversity. And of course, I didn't mention when I spoke Spain as one of the countries that are also exemplary for the EU, and I think definitely Spain is also very much taken on board in our research project, precisely because of this regional diversity. And yeah, there were some very interesting points you made. I might have some questions later on. No. But I think we have to move to Elisabetta for reasons of time as well. And then we will have, I see on the schedule, of course, Professor Luisa Antoniolli, who will have a roundup summary of today. So, Elisabetta, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. So, good afternoon to everyone. And my presentation aims at reflecting upon the concept of linguistic barriers. The microphone.
Yeah, thank you.
Can we move it?
Yeah,
we can.
Okay, my presentation aims at reflecting upon the concept of linguistic barriers, so I'm not going to focus on a specific barrier, but I'm going to pose some questions, and namely, what do we mean by linguistic barriers, and how to deal with, and should or can linguistic barriers be overcome or not? And first of all, to deal with linguistic barriers means to deal with a variety of barriers, and the analysis of the various barriers deriving from linguistic diversity needs to properly address a number of issues connected to the role language may perform at both the national and European level. So, first of all, what about the role of language? And language is a tool for communication and a factor of integration, of course, and think about social and political integration, the comprehension of relevant documents, avoiding misunderstandings in contacts with administrative and legal authorities, for instance, and so it is instrumental in providing access to citizenship rights. But the role of language, and we have seen in Catalonia, but also here in Trento, and above all in South Tyrol, it's a very important example of this identitarian function of language. So the problem and of the protection of linguistic minorities, linguistic rights, so multiculturalism and multilingualism. And what about the EU identity? So on the one hand, multilingualism plays an important role in shaping the European cultural identity and the legal system of the European Union, also considering that language is a fundamental tool to foster citizens' participation in society. But on the other hand, the linguistic diversity imposes new challenges to the European law in order to avoid disproportionate obstacles deriving from linguistic requirements, for instance. And in this from this perspective, we should also consider the increase of linguistic diversity due to mobility, to new immigration phenomena within the EU, and the promotion of minority languages and cultures, and the importance of the protection of individual and collective language rights is also testified by the type of sources of law that are constitutional law, international law, and European law. And again, Catalonia, but also South Tyrol, for instance, and so on. But then language has also a role as regards lexical. Think about legal language, scientific language, and the problem of translation, of legal translation. So linguistic barriers deal with all this aspect of these roles of language, and communication and lexicons are connected to the exercise of rights, and especially as far as the role of information is concerned. Consumers, for instance, but also informed consent as regards passions, for instance. But again, what do we mean by linguistic barriers? And I would like to stress this idea that linguistic barriers are hindrances to the exercise of a citizenship right that can derive from linguistic requirement to the or by the imposition of a translation. We have seen professionals in the professional fields, or the translation of contracts, or labeling, for instance. But there can also be hindrances to the exercise of a citizenship right derived from the lack of linguistic skills and or the lack of translation. And just to have some examples, this is a case of the European Court of Justice regarding free movement, the freedom of movement for workers and the linguistic knowledge and linguistic requirements. So it was similar to the Angonese case, and to some extent. So by requiring candidates for posts in the local services established in the French-speaking or German-speaking regions whose diplomas or certificates do not show that they were educated in the language concerned to provide evidence of their linguistic knowledge by means of one particular type of certificate issued only by one particular Belgian body, following an examination conducted by that body in Belgium, has failed to fulfill the obligation under the treaty. So just to give an example of a barrier, of a linguistic barrier that derives from the linguistic requirements or translation or whatever. But another example, Italy versus Commission is another case, quite recent case, and related to the notice of open competition for the recruitment of administrators and assistants, and the publication was made in four, only in three of the official languages. And the Italian Republic seeks to have set aside the judgment of the General Court of the European Union, by which this court dismissed the action brought by the Italian Republic seeking annulment of the notice of the open competition could constitute a reserve pool of administrators. And actually, there were these two main problems, ground of appeal. So the fact that the publication in full was made only in English, French, and German, and the second language, the choice of the second language, also as regards the written test, was possible only in English, French, and German, and the court held that stress the assumption that citizens of the European Union read the official journal of the European Union in their mother tongue, and a potential candidate whose mother tongue was not one of the languages of full publication of the contested competition notices would have had to obtain that journal in one of those languages and read the notice in that language before deciding whether to apply to take part in one of the competitions. And such a candidate was a disadvantage compared to a candidate whose mother tongue was one of the three languages of full publication. And so it was a difference in treatment on the ground of language that is prohibited according to EU law. So just to give another example of a lack of the publication in this case, in all languages, okay? So the practice of restricted publication does not observe the principle of proportionality and amounts therefore to discrimination on the ground of language. So discrimination on the ground of language, deriving from a lack of publication in all languages, EU languages. And also as regards the second language for participation in the competitions and tests, although the court held that the interest of the service may be a legitimate objective, there was actually no proportionality and no and the decision of the commission was not based on sufficient grounds. And so the court sets aside the judgment of the general court and annuls the notices of open competitions. And then linguistic barriers are also good, offer a good viewpoint to analyze the differences between factual and legal barriers. And factual barriers are barriers that, although often regulated by the law, derive from factual situations. For example, the coexistence of two or of more different linguistic groups, multilingualism again. And legal barriers are barriers that are directly derived from legal rules, such as different regulations between EU member states concerning language, knowledges, or linguistic requirement. And I would like to reflect upon this concept that probably is actually the passage from factual to legal that is important to analyze. And we have seen something like that in the previous presentation. So I think it is important to analyze this passage, this shift, this transition from factual to legal, to understand how to deal with linguistic barriers. And this is connected also to the role of the law. Because in factual barriers, the function performed by the law is to regulate a factual situation that is at the origin of a hindrance to some rights. So law is considered as a tool. Whereas in legal barriers, rules themselves create a barrier to the exercise of a given right, so law is a limit. And so do we need to avoid this transition from factual to legal linguistic barriers? It's just a question, I mean, connected to the role that law may perform, or is the concept of barrier itself that is at stake? As in both cases, may we speak about barriers or not? Or is a problem we need to avoid the transition from factual to legal linguistic barriers? So do we need to reflect on the law of the law? And that's why I think that the analysis of the reasons justifying a linguistic requirement is essential in order to understand how to properly balance the rights concerned. And to understand the strategy to cope with or to mitigate or to overcome a given linguistic barrier. Because sometimes a linguistic barrier may be based on the need to protect a given fundamental right or a specific public interest. And again, we have seen the role of languages, and so linguistic barriers are an interesting perspective to analyze also the clash between rights and to analyze also the different roles of what can be perceived as a linguistic barrier, and is connected also to what can be considered the language dimension of fundamental EU freedoms. To cross-national mobility means also to cross language frontiers. And just to give an example, the doctor and patient's relationship, knowledge of language that is imposed to professionals and in the medical field, according to Article 53 of the directive. And this contrast may be imposed if the profession to be practiced has patient safety implications. But what about linguistic requirements in cross-border care? So from the physician's point of view, this contrast, the knowledge of language, affect economic rights. But on the other hand, I mean, from the point of view of the patient, the lack of language skills affect fundamental rights, social rights, right to health, self-determination. So once again, the same linguistic requirement can be considered from two perspectives, or they can be opposite but interrelated perspective. And it is actually the same linguistic requirement that can show us the role, the different role of language, the different role of linguistic requirements, and the different way of dealing with linguistic barriers. So something that is considered to be a linguistic barrier from one point of view is actually could turn to be a barrier from the other perspective if it is not imposed, if it is a lack of language skills. And Another example, consumer protection, free movement of goods. So setting specific language requirements can be an indirect obstacle to the free movement of goods. But on the other hand, fundamental principle of consumer protection as the right to information on properties and factions of products. And what about the competence of a member state to impose additional language requirement? On the one hand, it is limited by the fact that such conditions are barrier to trade insofar as products coming from other member states have to be given different labeling involving additional package cost. But on the other hand, can be justified by a public interest in consumer protection. Product information is of no practical value unless it is given in a language that the consumer understands, and the language easily understood concept is consistently applied by the European Court of Justice and can be criticized, of course, but it's important to stress again the problem of proportionality and once again the role of rights and the shift between factual and legal barriers in order to understand the reason behind the linguistic barriers in order to understand how to deal with this barrier and to manage to cope with this barrier or to try to overcome it. And I will run. I'm just concluding and just an example. According to European Court of Justice, EU law does not preclude national legislation that prescribes the use of specific language for the labeling of products, so long as the legislation also permits the use of another language as an alternative that is easily understood by consumers. But easily understood problems of language and just two ideas concerning tools that can be helpful in this context. Education, of course, and education, the role of education is important as regards to the different roles of language we have seen, integration, identity, diversity, but also professional training, and here again in South Ireland and the Trento province, but I think also in other regions that are that need to cope with linguistic identity. Education may perform an interesting role in protecting, promoting local identity, linguistic identity, but also in promoting European studies and the knowledge of European languages. And since language and cultural barriers are limits to the level of cross-border mobility in Europe, the promotion of language skills could foster geographic mobility, and knowledge of language can have a direct and indirect effect. Direct, it reduces language barriers, and from an indirect point of view, it may reduce the cultural barriers preventing mobility, and the promotion of education abroad could foster cross-border mobility, could reduce language and cultural barriers. And then, and this is actually the last slide, also, I would like to stress the importance of the bottom-up approach, so the role of all these of the bodies and association then can have an influence on citizenship, on categories of citizenship, like consumer association, professional association, that can play a role in promoting more sensitivity towards the importance of language skills, language knowledge, and so have a role also in dealing with and coping with linguistic barriers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Elisabetta, for your very interesting presentation. And on language, I mean, in the EU, how many official languages do we have? I think 22, is that the correct number? 22 or something like that. And then, of course, we have, I when I was in a couple of weeks ago in at another meeting in Brussels, which I was ordered to attend by our project officer in Brussels, Yuri Borgman, but it was actually very interesting. It was also a group dealing with language, linguistic issues, but then, for example, looking at new developments in language, for example, street language, language in cities, in big cities like London, Berlin, Paris, where you have a kind of new language developing, which is also from an integration perspective very interesting. So, yeah, what I, both you and Sylvia, of course, when you look at language as a tool for integration, promoting inclusion in a way in a society, but at the same time, of course, constituting the barrier, one of the barriers, when you want to move to another member state and you are confronted with all kind of problems related to language. So there are these two or various sides to it. Okay, I stop here. Thank you so much for these three wonderful presentations. Are there any questions from you here? There are not that many left, but I think that doesn't mean that, I think that's very good for the content of the, so please feel free to shoot. Yeah, Martin.
I think what the presentation made clear is the importance of language, that there's basically, it's can be a double-edged sword.
Yeah.
In the sense that, you know, without language, there's no integration, you know, people both ways. What I find interesting when,
From the UK perspective is that it is basically equality law going back to the 1960s, which in the UK guarantees translators, for example, for access to health services. It has nothing to do with the European Union, but actually everyone has the right to access to a translator, which I think is a fundamental, so not the European Union rights, but it's in terms of equalities rights and Commonwealth history.
Mm. Yeah.
And what is also very interesting is they have that through very many services, but except for the NHS, the current government has actually abolished it because of European Union, right? Because the Poles were taking advantage of that. You know, they were translating, so if you, for example, just imagine, in Italy, your local recycling plan would be translated in three or four languages for people to be able to participate. Very common in the United Kingdom, right? Mm. Farsi, Polish, Romanian. It's like, which I think has, when we think about this, has nothing to do with the European Union, but with equalities.
Mm.
At the same time, not having a tough English test in the UK, you know, many people can pass them easily without being able to communicate, is this big issue that in terms of the skills structure, if you have a low-wage economy, you might not need language skills to such an extent as if you're more reliant on high skills as the Danish economy is. Mm-hmm. So it's whether by not requiring tough language tests, you entrap migrants in certain occupations. Right, so I think there's no clear way to come down on this, I think that these three presentations made that really, really clear from very different perspectives, and one should be really careful about judgments of whether to require or not require a language, and what it actually means.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, talking about equality, for example, I think that which is something very important is when a country or a region, as Catalonia, decides to teach the language for free, sometimes it is important that when they do that, they take into account to whom they are teaching it. Because I was to these courses of Catalan, and for me it was very easy, not only because I am from Spain, because if you have a high level for you, it's more or less easy. But sometimes they should take into account that there are many people who they have an oral knowledge of the language, for example. And sometimes those tests are not thought for somebody who, in their own language, would have a problem. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I miss, for example, in Catalonia. Why is the exam a written exam, for example?
Written exam, why?
Why? Mm. And it's so important that you have to put everything no fault, etc. I mean, then there are many people you are wiping them out, because I was in a class and there were people that have problems like, what is a verb? Because they were coming for places, but they couldn't attend to school, for example. So I said, why not an oral exam?
Can I supplement? The Danish language education is by law decided and is structured in three courses. So the first course is devoted to people who have a very short education, maybe an alphabet, and they will follow just the Danish one. So where they will be taken care of this. And then the one with middle education until high school, they will be in Danish too. And then all the rest, the one that have more than high school, so university, they will be put in Danish 3. And it's around 15,000 in 1 and 2 and 15,000 in 3. And the exams that gives access to nationality is only for the number 3. So you have to be careful with wishing that it's more diversified, because then you can use the law actually to also very, very difficultly to understand, but actually discriminate who's going to be able to pass a test that qualify them in the end.
But what I mean is, sometimes a native speaker, for example, speaks perfectly their language, but you as a foreigner maybe can pass better an exam if the exam is, because the language exams are sometimes like, we know which question normally they are.
Couldn't that be so because they really want to emphasize the importance of the Catalan language? I mean, that you must be able to not only speak it, but also know it in writing. I mean, that's something even more important in this regional kind of discussion in Spain, that they want to emphasize. I don't know. I mean, it's second guessing, whereas maybe a country imposing language requirements like Denmark does, or the Netherlands, or other countries, that they of course, they have various aims to strive for, but one certainly is that people in the first place learn to participate in the country, and they get included into the society. I think that's an important tool of these languages.
Especially when the host country is so much closed onto itself.
Yeah.
That's the problem. But the problem is that, as in many other things, themes that have to do with migration and migrants, it's always the responsibility is placed on the shoulder of the migrant. The responsibility to learning the language is, of course, of the migrant, but then there is a responsibility of the host society to make itself welcoming also to people speaking with an accent, or people maybe not speaking to or with other names. English? Oh, you mean that everybody, special test? I think it's the most common. I mean, everybody, also in the older generation. Before in time, it was German and Swedish that were taught in school. But now this has disappeared. Now there are other languages as well, but English is almost, because everywhere, if you go more than 50 kilometers away from the capital, then you are in another country, so you have to speak English. In this way, it has a special status. But
and at high schools, because in the Netherlands, it's compulsory to have English, at least. That's the first foreign language.
Yeah.
And then you can choose French, German, other foreign
languages.
Chinese, Spanish. Yeah. But English, you should always take English as second language. Maybe kind of status you are looking for, but you have to take English in your high school, and you start in primary school with English.
Mm. Yeah, it's like that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Other questions? Yeah, Martin.
Academia, and see where. Outside of the United Kingdom, we see huge percentages of non-nationals teaching in academia, right? It's in those countries. So basically, we're, high mobility of other EU citizens. It's in those countries, small European countries, that have basically switched to English, right? Whether it's the Netherlands or all of Scandinavia, in terms of, if you think about academics living or teaching in a country that is not their native language, with the exception of the United Kingdom, it is only in the Nordic countries where that happens. If you look at France, at Germany, Italy, So where the language communities are much bigger, so where they can survive and recruit, as they believe, good academics from within,
an endless pool.
They don't need those. But those countries, and pardon? I think law is an exception, but if you look at the actual numbers, right, of academics moving and teaching in Denmark, and that's also the question of to what extent are language requirements enforced among academics in Denmark? Probably not very much, similar to in, you know, friends of mine in Netherlands, although they have these language requirements. As long as these people teach, and they usually teach in these English courses, and so what I'm saying is, in terms of mobility, the small, open, Northwest European countries have an advantage because they are small. They have realized that only by using English can they actually stay competitive, which has a positive benefit on EU citizenship because it allows other EU citizens to work in those countries, despite the problems that they are there. But just imagine, you know, you teaching at a German university, you will not have that many English, you know, as we find in the Netherlands or in Scandinavia, or just even imagine in France, where now only at Sciences Po they have introduced English, but basically everything is in French. And I think there are issues that we should really think about in terms of whether other countries can learn from these small open economies where English has become the lingua franca. Mm-hmm.
No, I certainly agree with you, Martin. I think that that's definitely the case. And law is indeed an exception because that's also in the Netherlands. We are really willing to employ more foreigners in the law school, but it's a problem because many of the courses are still in Dutch. So you can do that as long as they can speak and understand and also have to write properly Dutch. But I think there are various factors. Language is certainly a very important one, but there's also, when it comes to open competitions and the way in which the labor market is structured, I think that's different from country to country. In the Netherlands, it's, I guess, rather open. Also, the university, the academic world is similar to the UK, I think, in that sense, that the competitions are rather open and also outsiders from your own university have a chance, in fact, to get a job as a professor or as a teacher, as a lecturer. Whereas I understand in Italy that, for example, but also in France, because I know that from my brother's wife, they live in France, that it's extremely difficult to, even if you speak fluently French, but you are not really, you have not studied at that university, etc., to really get a good position there. It's really difficult. So I think there are various factors that play a role, but language and the lingua franca, English, of course, certainly as well. Yeah, I have a lot of questions, but I think we leave that maybe for this evening, dinner.
Of course.
Because I would like to invite Professor Luisa Antoniolli, I should say. Is that correct? Yes. Because you have the final word, the final say. Thank you. I'm sorry, this is not a, you have the honor to. Yeah.
Oh. Is there a pen? Somebody else?
I have one.
Okay. It's a difficult task for a number of reasons. First of all, because it's 7 o'clock. I think everybody is starting to look for dinner with a variation again. Probably the Spanish will be in a better position off than the Dutch and the English. So here, there again, we might have a multiple speed. And also because it's actually very difficult to wrap it up because there were so many inputs and so many issues that were raised. So let me try just to pick up some of the subject. It won't be comprehensive, but I hope it's some help to get out something of this very rich exposition. By the way, I'm very impressed by the breadth of this project, not just by the numbers of countries that are involved, but also by the scope and the subject that are coming into. And
my experience, I was telling to some of you, I work here at the Faculty of Law, but also at the School of International Studies, which is a center, a graduate school, where lawyers together with economists and political scientists, historians and philosophers are teaching. And there, you really have a sense on how fruitful it is to cooperate. It's not easy because, of course, even though you're looking at the same problem, the vocabulary and the methodologies are so different that every now and then you are talking about the same thing, but you don't understand what the other is saying. But at the same time, clearly some of the problems cannot simply be understood simply by looking at those problems from one perspective. So I think the involvement of historians together with lawyers, possibly linguists, political scientists, I think that's a definitely an added value to any kind of analysis. Now, in the variety of intervention that we had today, I think there were two major issues that were recurrent in the presentation. One was about the relationship between the economic-driven integration and the social aspect of that integration that has come in the first presentation by Flavio, Paolo as well, Martin, and I think there you really have what is fascinating to see is how things have evolved over time, because in the beginning, clearly the issue of free movement was an economic freedom. You were entitled to move because you were a worker. So in fact, it was not about having rights as such, but it was about acknowledging the existence of factors of production, and if you wanted to have a common market, then you have to have factors of production moving around. So goods had to be moved around, services, but also people. And since people are quite different than goods and services, then you have to devise some kind of mechanism in order to make sure that they could move. But of course, the focus was purely economic. Now, over time, things have changed. They have changed a lot. But I still think that DNA of that kind of freedom has remained. And today, what we are witnessing is that although we speak about European Union citizenship, when you grab out the surface, you still are there. And I think your presentation was absolutely fascinating in showing that you do have a right as a European Union citizens to move around, but when you look into the details, it's not quite so. You can, but there are high costs for that. The situation varies according whether or not you are economically active. So the economic origin is still there. And of course, there's a strong link between how you exercise the right and the welfare and social model that you have in the first place. Now, this is the crucial aspect of the incompleteness of the integration process in Europe. When Robert Schuman made the famous discourse, and now a few days ago we had the coming of the 9th of May, but that went fairly unnoticed, I must confess, in Italy. His idea was, let's start with economic integration, and gradually over time we'll get to political integration. Now, we did have economic integration. Political integration is still far away, and it seems that it's even more distant than it used to be in the past, but that has encroached so much on economic integration. So when Flavio was describing the cohesion funds, and he was exactly saying, well, it's not quite the same thing as what happens in a state, either a unitary state as Italy or even a federal state like Canada or the US. Why? Because we don't have a real fiscal harmonization at the European level. The European Union budget is around 1%, something more than 1% of the overall GDP of the whole European Union countries. So it's not possible to have this kind of redistributive mechanism that you have in a nation state. And we don't want to have it, because when it comes into doing that, you can see that the national resistances are so strong. So right now, when we are discussing about giving financial help to states in distress after the financial crisis, you can see very clearly that we're going to give the money, but the money has to come back. No bailout. And the Germans are very keen on that. We can devise mechanisms in order to help the state to come out of the financial difficulties, but no issues of having solidarity among the states. The money has to come back. And in order to make sure that that happens, you have the IMF on board, and they are very keen on getting the money back. So I think these exercises show that economic integration per se can work up to a certain limit, and after that there must be a clear political decision on how much solidarity you want to have. And for the moment, it doesn't seem that we're very much looking for that. Partly for good reasons, historical reasons. The welfare models, as you underline, are completely different in the Nordic states as opposed to the Mediterranean countries and the new acceding countries of the East. But it's partly because we have this perverse idea that if you strike to the middle, this is going to be fine for everybody. And that was the idea behind the euro. And when the crisis broke out, we were in trouble. Why? Because the euro was working on the idea that you have something as an average which did not exist. And to that, I think we as lawyers can work on trying to build on the notion that we have created. So the fundamental freedoms were essential in constructing new kind of interpretation that were also fostering social development. Then we had the European Union citizenship, which was quite a I don't know how you call it in English, but we have a say in Italian that says that we have the mountains that give birth to our mice. The grand idea of having something like a citizenship sounds wonderful, but then when you look at the content, as you rightly pointed out, the content is very marginal. It's a derivative kind of citizenship, and it's just about rights and no duties. So we have been working on that. The European Court of Justice has been trying to force the meaning of the European citizenship in order to grant some social rights, but there's a limit to what can be done through that kind of mechanism. So apart from trying and stretch the interpretation and make a systematic use of principles, like, for example, the principle of non-discrimination, fundamentally, at a certain point, you need to have a thoroughly political decision on how much you want to integrate and how much solidarity you want to have. And I think from that point of view, there's also a kind of, excessive expectation on the possibility, on the potential of law. Law has been an essential tool. A lot of integration has been going on by using legal means, for example, case law of the Court of Justice, but also production of rules. But at the end of the day, and this is particularly clear, for example, in what has been done in the tackling of the crisis, of the governance of the financial economic crisis, at the end of the day, this is a kind of toolbox that works only if you have the political decisions that are taken behind it. Whereas we're trying to make it upside down. We are trying to push the legal integration by stretching the interpretation and the systematic construction, hoping that it will lead us some kind of new political governance and political scenario. But that's not going to happen, I think. The problem is that maybe we've gone too far. That by now, it has been so successful, we've been integrating so much and enlarging so much in terms of numbers of member states, that it's going to be difficult for us to find a political compromise that will allow us to move beyond that. But I think what Martin's presentation has shown very well is that you cannot stay for long in the middle ground, because you cannot talk about European citizenship and freedom of movement when in fact, when you look at how things work, this is just going in one direction and not in the other. And people start to feel that sense that while in the past Europe was something that was empowering in them, you are now gradually feeling people feeling that the European Union is taking away rights and security. And this is why the right-wing parties, anti-European parties, are gaining position everywhere, in Italy, in France, in the UK, in Sweden, even in states that had traditionally no strong parties of that kind. And I think that's a sign of the fact of people being fearful of the integration process in itself. So I think that's a very severe kind of crisis, and it's due to this inbuilt tension and imbalance between the economic side of integration versus the social and political side of integration. The other big theme was the issue of languages and what languages are for the European integration process. Now, I must confess, I'm always very surprised by how little attention lawyers, but not just lawyers, social scientists in general, give to the importance of the linguistic aspect for the European Union integration process, because we've got 23 languages. It's an enormous amount of languages. And not only that, but we have decided on purpose not to recognize the fact that we have one official preeminent languages. That was the discussion going on. What about English? Well, of course, we are speaking English, and if you go to the European Commission, they are speaking English. If you are recruited in a university, they're going to ask you whether you speak English or not. But that's just what you call a lingua franca. So legal as opposed to factual. Legally, there's no doubt that Europe, as elsewhere in the world, English is the language that everybody has to speak. And in fact, I think that right now, the majority of national systems compel their children to learn first English. Then you can learn some other language, but first of all, it's English. Even here, for example, in this region, where it used to be German, because we are close to the German-speaking area, but right now, children have first to learn English and then German. So that's surely... it makes a difference, but legally, if you don't recognize that, then you are in trouble, because it means that all the official documents and all the official activity must take place in all the languages. And I think it was interesting, the example that you made about this case by the Court of Justice requiring just three languages being set for the notice of competition. Of course, you cannot do that. 23 languages is just too much, it's unmanageable. But then, of course, if you say all the languages, it's like the Orwell things. All animals are equal, but some are more equal than others. And so it is for our languages in Europe. They are all equal, but some are more equal than others, of course. So I think this is also something that needs to be recognized. There's no easy way out, because of the way that we understand the European Union, it is very difficult to accept that one language is going to be the preeminent one. But I don't think that any system that has 23 official languages can work without having one language being recognized as being the official one. I don't think Europeans are ready to do that, but unless they are, I don't think there's any way to come out of the problem. So I think languages is really a problem. And not only that, but from a substantial point of view, I think that the language issue is a crucial issue of factual barrier to mobility. A very long time ago, I made a research together with a colleague in labor law about mutual recognition of diplomas, and we were looking about how lawyers were moving around. Now, the picture was very easy. There were very few lawyers moving, and they were moving from Austria to Germany, from Belgium to France, and from Ireland to the UK. That's it. Is it surprising? No, of course it is not. But if you look at it from a legal point of view, it's astonishing, because our legal situation is that we are actually more harmonized than, for example, the US. Because if you're a lawyer, you have a right to establish elsewhere. The problem is that unless you don't know the language, you won't be able to work. But formally, you can. In the US, usually, you don't have a right, because the bar exam is a state exam, which means that if you move from Oklahoma to Idaho, whatever, you may have to sit for the bar exam once more. Is it a problem? Of course not. Why? Well, because you speak English, and because the law that you learn, no matter where you went to university, is American law. So that means that it's not a problem. So this issue of the relevance of the language from a factual point of view as opposed to the legal point of view is something that I think we tend to underestimate to a very wide extent, not just as lawyers. And I don't know what the answer is, because I think that all in all, our diversity in language is an enormous richness, something that must be protected. But at the same time, if we are thinking about harmonizing and having some kind of real integration at the European level, we must cope with the fact that this is not manageable and we need to work for at least having one language, which, by the way, is not just in terms of economic freedoms, of, for example, freedom of establishment, but also for the identity of the European Union. I think what is more missing in this period of crisis in Europe is the sense that you are a polity, and you have a sense that you are a polity if you can communicate. Now, if you just read a newspaper, Italian newspaper, but I'm fairly sure it's going to be the same for a Dutch newspaper, maybe you hear something about Brexit because it's just around the corner, or about the Greeks because they may again become bankrupt, but you don't have a real sense of what is going on in other countries which are part of the European Union. And if you don't have a sense that you know what is going on and that you share the destiny, because what is happening in Poland and Hungary might be relevant, not just for them, but also for you, you're not going to have a sense that integrating and also having solidarity might make sense. So I think the language issue is really something on which we should be thinking more thoroughly, and also, I think, make an effort not just to better have knowledge of languages, and I think on that, at least in Italy, we are making very significant progress. I must confess, I teach in English here in Trento, and 10 years ago, you could hardly have two or three people that were willing to try and do that. Right now, we have several dozens of people that are willing to follow a course in English and give an exam and moving abroad. So I think we must work on that and recognize that the sense of citizenship also passes through the idea that we are able to communicate, and languages, of course, is the means through which you communicate. Okay, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Luisa, for this very interesting conclusion. I think it was very, very, well, challenging what you said. And so, well, just say thank you very much to all of you. And I think, from my point of view, it has been a very, very stimulating seminar, and I really learned a lot. And so, really, thank you very much for your work, and I hope we will go on with the discussion during the dinner. The dinner was originally planned at 8, but if you want, we can also postpone it of half an hour, so you can rest a little bit. And okay, so thank you very much again.